Computer. Okay, so there's Neil, there's Eric. It's just the three of us today. But fortunately, one of them is Neil, so we'll have plenty of chatter.
I hope so. Senseless chatter.
Are we going to get a chance to plug your book yet, or is that still on the down low?
It's in the window at Comics Revolution in Evanston, so I think it's still out. I think we can plug away.
Well, so, you were at the book fair. Was it last week?
I was at the book fair a week ago. God, it's hard. What is today? Today's Wednesday. A week ago Sunday. Yeah.
Oh, it was the really rainy day.
Right. Well, you've read it.
Yes.
Right, Eric, in theory, so we should ask you what you think. I'm keen to hear.
I'm loving it. So.
Oh, good.
Yeah, no, it's a really fun book. You're not alone.
It's not only is it a good book, it's a history book every day in Chicago. What's the title? Hey, Neil, what's the title of your new book? Here we go.
The title of my new book is Every Day.
Did you run that by people? Did my
mother doesn't like it. Mm-hmm. There's actually more. It's Every Day, highly selective, definitely opinionated, and alternatingly humorous and heartbreaking historical tour of Chicago. It's the name of the blog. So that my hands were sort of tied. That's the reason that they asked me to write it. So I did get, you know, it's funny because it's in the Rotary magazine in September. And so I'm hearing from Rotarians that are just, you know, that I would call it this. And I kind of use that as what they call a teaching opportunity where I say, you understand there's other people and they believe other things. And so one reason I called the blog that was to let people like you know that this isn't really where you're not your happy, safe space. And that's a revolution for them. I mean, half the issues we have in politics are people who just can't get their heads around the fact that there are other people who believe other things, and they get to live here too and have books in their library and all sorts of things like that. I just wish, maybe being Jewish, but I learned that a long time ago.
Yeah, but then the title of the book or blog could have been, hey, there's room for everybody here, Neil Steinberg.
Or it could have been Embrace Christ, but that wasn't what I picked. You know, I mean, yeah, it could have been something else, but this was my book and this is reflecting my philosophy. And so again, not everything is for everyone.
Yeah, but the book is utterly accessible. Nobody will take offense to anything in the book. The title is the only questionable thing in there.
I disagree. It's got a lot of racial history. Some people down in Florida can't even learn that stuff. Stuff about race, yeah, stuff about labor. I disagree with that, John. I think there's stuff in the book that if you are, I don't see you, you're not there point of view, then you're going to, you know, there's gay history. There's Gertrude.
Yeah, but it's gay history. It's not gay. It's not. It's race history. It's violence history. It's not an endorsement per se of violence or advocating for LGBTQ communities.
Neither's Mouse or, you know, Judy Blume or half the things that get banned. Again, I can't accept that it's just some anodyne pap that has a shocking title on it. No,
okay,
there's
your new title. It's not anodyne pap. And then put a QR code for a shocking title here.
Yeah,
I get it. I'm just so, pulling your leg.
I know. Originally the title was Every Day : Neil Steinberg Chicago, and then they came up with this enormous title. I think it has to do with Google search algorithms or something.
I
got
the
them to cut
words.
It in half to the merely long title that they have now. But this is my ninth book, and I think I love this one best of all. When you turned it in, I published this one. I just had fun doing it.
Yeah, I know you're really enthusiastic about it, and it really is the 366. How many stories?
Yes. Six. Thank God, in 1960, Hugh Hefner opened the Playboy Club on February 29th. So it was very easy. The history of that was really, I don't know if you noticed, it was like a pure business thing. They had done a story on the Gaslight Club in Chicago, which sold memberships. And they realized, hey, we could run a really expensive restaurant and get people who were never going to go to pay for the privilege of coming should they find it. And so there was, I mean, it's a genius thing where we think of it as sort of a dowdy, you know, 1960s white elephant, but at the time it was pretty brilliant.
So you're reading these for John's show, right, Neil? I mean, you guys have recorded some of those.
Do you tell me, John? Am I?
Yeah, Neil came in and cut some specs for us, and we're trying to find a way to slot them on the radio. That hasn't happened yet, so stay tuned, as they say.
Yeah, we're trying to. We have a sponsor, and so there's money on the table, and I'm willing to do it. I think it would be fun. I think it'd be good for the show. It'd be good for the book. It'd be good for me.
Be good for America. Your agent, Eric Zorn, has been championing this idea.
He has been. Thank you, Eric. I should send you a basket of muffins or something. Because I do appreciate, as opposed to my mother, I went to visit my mother yesterday, and she said, because I gave her a copy of the book, of course, and she said, I read your book. I said, and? It's good, but it jumps around a lot. And I almost said, you know, it's written already and out there now, Mom. So this is sort of like the get behind your son, the author. I mean, just in case anyone is considering buying it, but is worried that it's not linear enough. It does not start in 1673 with Marquette and Joliet showing up and then march through steadily. It sort of goes in this jumping around fashion, but I like to think there's a certain cohesion that still takes place.
Well, it's a day by day recollection of great moments or unknown, untold stories about Chicago's history.
Right.
There be a thread?
Right. It would be utterly impossible. But, you know, again, I'm not saying my mother isn't necessarily the most trenchant critic.
Well, here's what you should have done. Here's what you should have done, honey. You should have said, like, at the end of January 1st, you know, you go, speaking of the Spanish Inquisition, the Bears won the Super Bowl in 19, you know, just
find it. She also forgets that she tends not to like the, you know, every book there's something like that, the complete and utter failure. It had failure in the title. You know, she'll explain to me later why it didn't do well. But again, you know, what I should have said was buy the damn book, Mom.
Okay, on our podcast today, let's do there's five things I think we can try and address most of them. The Mexican Independence Day, David Brown is scoring that as a win, how the city handled it. Governor DeSantis of Florida and Abbott of Texas sending people here, and Lori Lightfoot's next budget, she said, will allocate money to handle the people that are coming from Texas. The Mega Millions winners, we don't know who they are. There's two of them. They're each going to get $390 million. And to piss my listeners off, I said that whoever those people are, they have a moral obligation to give most of it away. And very few people agreed with me on that. And I was kind of disappointed. Donald Trump's family and family business, and Letitia James Crosshairs. And that was pretty amazing what we saw about that today. And then we have those two police officers who are charged in the shooting of a 23-year-old man and shooting at a juvenile. The video of that looks bad for the cops, and we got another one of those stories, don't we? So those are things on my mind today. Anything else you want to throw in there before we get started?
I have to leap and tell Eric to be careful about this. Now, remember Adam Toledo, okay? Just because you don't work for the Tribune anymore, so you don't have to worry as much. But still, I think about that column because Eric wrote a completely rational, hey, let's look at all the facts kind of column, and wasn't quite dragged out in the middle of Grant Park and crucified, but it was pretty close.
Yeah, that's true. On the other hand, the video from this particular incident is pretty stark. And I wrote a great deal about Laquan McDonald. No, everyone seemed to forget that they thought I was rushing to the defense of the police, but I ripped the cops every which way on Laquan McDonald. So I feel like that was my critics were taking things not only wrongly, but well out of context.
Well, they there is no context. They're criticizing whatever's like sitting in front of them. Okay, you know, you could have been supporting truth, justice, and the American way since before they were born, and none of that matters. They may not even know because they're in some other distant state.
Well, which one should we start on?
Which because topic? We can start on that video. That's a good. I do have all the facts. I mean, I don't have the dates and names and stuff right in front of me. But I
got a good enough write-up of it. I think we can start it. All right, we'll do that now. Here we go. Stand by.